What a privilege to be introduced by the voice of God. It's actually the Douglas Dillon chairman, so it's good to know that everybody is fallible in this universe. And it's a great privilege to be here this evening following extraordinary examples of treating remains. As an art historian, that is my field, and I have great respect for remains. I only wish, Jill, that you could have shared with a superwoman as well. In 1970, the Metropolitan Museum of Art celebrated its centennial. The next year, Tom Hoving and the newly appointed curator, actually the chairman of the Asian Art Department at the Met, invited me to become a curatorial assistant. Unfortunately, I looked at the Met's collection at that time. There were only two galleries of Asian art. Balcony had an exhibition of Chinese ceramics, and there was one room of Buddhist sculpture. Had nothing much to do with my interest in Chinese painting. So I declined. That is, I declined until Wen Fong introduced me to John Elliott. John Elliott was building a collection of calligraphy and painting with Wen Fong's help. And John advised me that I probably should take the job, that things were going to change at the Met. And he was right. In the next four decades, the Metropolitan Museum transformed itself. It became perhaps the most comprehensive collection of Asian art anywhere, with more than 50 galleries devoted to that particular area. For 43 of those years, that Met has also been my life. But of course, it had already been around for 100 years when I started. And 100 years after the American Academy had been founded, this is what the Metropolitan Museum looked like in Central Park. It was the first building in its new permanent home there. It was designed by Calvert Vo of Olmsted and Vo fame for Central Park. Vo also created a design for what the museum would look like in the future. And it's an extraordinary example of how people at this time envisioned the growth potential of America. And in fact, the first director of the Metropolitan Museum added an inscription at the bottom right, which says, "This is how the whole museum will look in 1990. He was actually exactly right. But it took a great leader, and it took J.P. Morgan, actually, to move the Met forward towards that goal. Morgan became a trustee of the museum in 1888. He served as its president from 1904 until his death in 1913. And it was really this model of the grand inquisitor, a man who pulled together arts from all over the world, that was the model for great museum trustees and directors alike. Under Morgan's leadership in 1902, the museum opened its grand Beaux-Arts entrance designed by Richard Morris Hunt. And after that, by 1908, the design for the McKim, Mead & White wings to either side of that entrance, the same architectural firm that had designed the Morgan Library in 1906. So when Morgan's death occurred in 1913, the museum had already created a design and a template for its future. And in fact, by 1920, right after the First World War, it had completed about half of its existing space. It didn't expand again for another 50 years on the outside. But on the inside, great things were happening. There were a tremendous number of self-made men who found in the arts a way to leave something behind for society, to repay society for the advantages they had had. I'd like to mention just two who also had tremendous contribution to the Asian art field. One of them was Heber Bishop. He was a man who invested in iron ore. He built railroads. The Third Avenue Elevated Railway was his contribution. In 1902, he left the Metropolitan Museum over 1,000 jades, mostly from the 19th and 18th centuries. It's an extraordinary collection. It is really preeminent in the United States for that period. He also endowed a space for the display of that, modeled on his ballroom on Fifth Avenue in the Louis XV style. Benjamin Altman was a humble clerk in his family's dry good business until he built the business into what became one of the great department stores in New York, B. Altman and Company. When he died in 1913, he endowed the museum with over 50 old master paintings and some 430 works of Chinese porcelain. So with these kinds of major contributions on the part of New York donors, the museum finally got around to establishing a Department of Asian Art. It was called Far Eastern Art at the time, in 1915. So we will be celebrating our centennial next year. The first curator of Asian art at the Met was a Dutchman. His name was Siegfried Chrétien Bosch Reitz. And he was about to become curator of Asian art for the Louvre when the First World War broke out and led him to emigrate to America, where he was hired by the Met. In the 12 years that he was curator of the department, he created an extraordinary legacy, collecting things like Chinese archaeological materials, these great Bronze Age artifacts, Buddhist sculpture, Japanese textiles, paintings, screens, and Buddhist sculpture. So it was an amazing start for a curatorial guidance to suddenly move beyond the decorative arts into the field of high art. Bosch Reitz was succeeded by a brash 30-year-old Harvard graduate student named Alan Priest. He remained in that job for 30 years, and during that time, he expanded the museum's collections in many ways, but particularly in the fields of sculpture. He added the first Central Asian and South Asian sculptures to the museum's collection, and after the Second World War, he also took advantage of that opportunity to add great works of Japanese art to the collection. But when Priest retired in 1963, he left the department almost rudderless. And by 1970, when the museum began to celebrate its centennial, the Department of Asian Art had shrunk to two galleries, less space than it occupied in 1902. The Buddhist Sculpture Hall and the balcony were the only areas where you could see Asian art at the Met. As a result, Tom Hoving, and the director at the time, and Douglas Dillon actively debated whether or not the museum should abandon those areas where it was weak and simply focus on its strengths, or to rededicate itself to being a truly encyclopedic museum. Happily, Douglas Dillon advocated for the latter. He got personally involved in that, and under Tom Hoving and his successor, Philippe de Montebello, the museum actually doubled in size from the time J.P. Morgan's era to the extent that it is now. It had fully occupied this footprint that had been envisioned in 1880 by Calvert Vaux. It was with Douglas Dillon's and Thomas Hoving's leadership that Wen Fong, professor of art history at Princeton, was invited to the Met to become the consultative chairman to the Department of Far Eastern Art in 1971. I was Wen Fong's first hire. Wen was a remarkable leader. He was there for three decades, and during that time, he built up the staff, he built up the collections, and he realized that you couldn't acquire works of art one by one. It was necessary for the museum to go after whole collections of Chinese painting, Japanese art, Indian and Southeast Asian sculpture. One of the other great benefactors of the museum was Brooke Astor. And in 1980, because of her childhood in Beijing, she was inspired by the acquisition of a group of Ming furniture to create a period room and a garden court. And this is a young Mike Hearn helping Mrs. Astor with the plans as we developed that program in 1980. That was the first of a sequence of new galleries that the department opened up in the next 20 years. In 1981, we opened a suite of galleries of Chinese painting. We couldn't even fill the galleries once with a rotation. But once we opened the galleries, collectors began to contribute their works to the museum, so that in 1997, we actually enlarged and renovated the entire suite of Chinese painting galleries. In 1975, the museum acquired about 700 works of art from a collector dealer named Harry Packard. And following that, we were able to go to the Japanese government and the Japanese business community and seek their support in building a suite of 10 galleries, which opened in 1987, celebrating the arts of Japan. That is going to go. There we go. In 1988, similar benefaction from Charlotte and John Weber enabled us to open expanded galleries for ancient China. And in 1994, we were able to inaugurate 18 galleries devoted to South and Southeast Asian art, named for Herbert and Florence Irving. And finally, in 1998, we completed the suite of galleries with galleries devoted to the arts of Korea, thanks to Samsung and the Korea Foundation. So within 30 years, the museum went from having virtually no Asian art on view to having the largest area devoted to Asian art in this country. It was Wen Fong's successor, James Watt, who took the helm of the department in 2000. And for the next 11 years, James used his extraordinary expertise in Chinese decorative arts to build up the museum's collection in areas of lacquer, metalwork, textiles, and other decorative arts. Since 2011, it's been my privilege to lead the department. It's been one of my great challenges and really delights to be able to expand my own area of interest in Chinese painting to cover all of Asia. We last year acquired a major group of artwork devoted from the countries of Nepal and Tibet. But another area that I've been really fascinated with is how can the museum extend its past down to the present? I feel like Asian art has very much a contemporary dimension, and so we have now made a policy of collecting contemporary art that has rooted in Asian traditions, such as calligraphic abstractions from China, deer that are, and other imagery that are derived from ancient Shinto images and mandalas, and also contemporary Cambodian sculpture that reflects the great heritage of Angkor Wat. But for me, the museum is far more than just a repository or guardian for mankind's cultural heritage. What the museum is really about is it's a legacy of hundreds of collectors, donors, staff members who have really put their lives into the service of humanity, into the service of knowledge and appreciation of the arts. And it's that legacy that I think really makes the Metropolitan Museum such an extraordinary institution. It is a place where our 6 million visitors a year can seek knowledge, find appreciation, and even attain solace. Becoming aware of the world's art and the fact that that art is really our combined cultural heritage, and it is also our combined challenge to maintain it, to preserve it, and pass it on. And for me, the Metropolitan Museum has been an extraordinary opportunity to enrich my life, and together with my wife Vera and our children Alex, Garrett, and Weiwei, I've really had not only a great career, but really a wonderful life. And so the honor bestowed upon me by the Academy is really theirs, and I thank them for that, as well as the Academy. Thank you.